Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our service this morning, which is being conducted by our minister, Reverend Malcolm Kinnear. Tomorrow at 12 noon, the funeral of Malcolm Jones will take place here in this church. On Tuesday at 12 noon, the interment of the ashes of Ian Duncan will take place at Kinnock Moor. On Tuesday at 7 p.m, there will be a Bible study and prayer meeting held in the church hall, to which all are welcome. On Wednesday, the Knit and Natter group will meet in the church hall at 2 p.m. Next Sunday is Remembrance Sunday. The service here will be conducted by our minister, the Reverend Malcolm Kinnear. And the service next Sunday will commence at 9:55 a.m. And then following the service here, there will be a service at the War Memorial at 11 a.m. There are puppies available. Donations to the Puppy Fund Appeal can also be made next week. Thank you.
Good morning to you all, and welcome. And welcome to you as we gather together on this, the Lord's Day. We come to worship the Lord and glorify Him. And as Arthur was saying, tomorrow we have the service for Malcolm Jones of Lays Road, who was attending here before lockdown, and after a period of ill health, he passed away just over a week ago. So we'll hold his widow, Doreen, and his son, Jack, in our prayers today. As we prepare to worship, we have a Bible verse that's on our sheet, which we'll say it together. If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. So let us worship God and sing to His praise. We begin with 31, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Thank you. As we worship here, we're joined by people who are joining us worshiping at home and joining us online from people as far away as Canada and Cundorrit and Cumbernauld and more locally. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, we praise you. And we give you glory for the mighty God that you are, a God most worthy of praise and of the highest honour. You are a God whose love is without end. You are faithful. We delight in your statutes. They enlighten the mind. They renew the heart. You are a God to be trusted, for you are true to your word and your promises. We praise you, for you alone are God. And you are our God. And you have made your purposes for us known in Jesus Christ. We thank you for your mercies received day by day. And most especially for the love and the grace that you have bestowed upon us freely in Jesus, in the gospel. We praise you and thank you for the offer of pardon and peace in him. How marvellous that you have set before us a Saviour, in whom we have life and a joyful friendship with you. How wonderful that you have made us your sons and daughters in Jesus. We gather before you in acknowledgement of your wonderful love. Even so, Lord, we confess our waywardness and our sinfulness, for so often we are inclined to go our own way and neglect the calling and commandments of faith. But we thank you that there is mercy and forgiveness with you, and that you strengthen, comfort, and direct us. And you have said that you will be our God to us, your children. We thank you that you have covenanted to be our friend and our Father in Christ. May we know, Lord, your forgiving mercies, your renewing grace, your empowering presence, the fullness of joy and the Holy Spirit. We thank you that in your love and mercy you receive us into your favour and you pardon our iniquities. As we wait upon you today, we pray that your blessing might fall upon us and upon all who are sharing in our worship, even later at different times and places. May we know your sanctifying grace in our hearts, the power and joy and anointing of your Holy Spirit that comes from being one with our Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, we ask it for his name's sake and to his glory. Amen. Thank you, Avro, for reading our scripture today. Let's turn now to hymn 330 in full. No, it's not. It's 581, isn't it? 581, River, Wash Over Me. Let's pray together. Most loving and gracious God, as we gather together in your name, we thank you that you're present with us. We pray you'd seal your word into our hearts, that we might grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray in his name. Amen. I always think it's interesting to learn people's nicknames. Tomorrow's service for Malcolm Jones, he was sometimes called Captain because he was a keen sailor. Often people's nicknames persist through their lives. Indeed, in many Highland communities, it seems that just about everyone was known by their nickname. Barnabas had a nickname, Son of Encouragement. He encouraged others, including the recent convert, Saul of Tarsus. Actually, the name Christian, which was first used at Antioch, was originally a nickname. People saw the followers of Jesus, and they saw something new, something different in them, something they couldn't quite describe without coining a new term to describe a new reality, something that they saw in the believers. Barnabas had another name, Joses, and he had been a Levite, and then he became a follower of Jesus. He was originally from Cyprus. He had land there which he sold and donated to the church. Now he is mentioned again, and Cyprus is mentioned too, for some of the believers from Cyprus came and preached in Antioch. It's coming up to Remembrance, and I've been trying to read about a little bit about parts of the British Empire and the part they played during the wartime. Cyprus was part of the British Empire, and in the First World War, Cypriots played a big part in the Allied side fighting in the Greek campaign. Cyprus was also a convalescent, used as a place for the injured to convalesce. There's so much history that we sometimes overlook. So anyway, the church in Jerusalem sent Barnabas to Antioch, having heard that good things were happening there. And when Barnabas got to Antioch, he saw what was happening. He saw the grace of God touching people's lives. The grace of God can be seen, can make a tangible difference when it creates an effect in people's lives, a new reality, and they come to the Saviour, and they receive his offer of peace and mercy. It creates a new reality that is tangible, that can be seen. And others had been noticing too, and so coined this new term, Christians. It wasn't, the believers tended to call themselves believers, disciples, saints, brethren, sisters, but this new term, Christian, kind of stuck, and it's been with us ever since. People often use the term a Christian, not in its true original sense. They use it to describe certain attitudes, values, ways of living, ways of behavior, either as Christian or unchristian. Sometimes the term is used almost just to describe kindly, loving, caring actions. But the thing is, these are what a Christian may do. These are things a Christian does. Caring, loving, kindly actions rather than what a Christian is. A person could be kind and caring and loving and not necessarily a Christian. And a person is not necessarily a Christian either because they've been brought up in a Christian country. So maybe that invites us to answer the question what a Christian is. Certainly this passage gives us somehow some clue to the answer as to how people become Christians. They hear Jesus preached. They hear the gospel. They hear how God came to our broken humanity in Jesus. They hear how Jesus gave himself upon the cross, dying and rising again, offering himself as Lord and Saviour. They hear the gospel of how that insuperable barrier between a holy God and sinful humanity was bridged. We couldn't bridge it on our own, but Christ stood in for us and in our place, dying the death that was ours. They hear the message, that message of the gospel, and believe it is true and receive God's offer of salvation, peace and pardon in the Saviour. They come to Jesus and own him, receive him as Lord and Master. They hear how Jesus offered his own life for us on the cross as a sinless substitute for sinners. He paid the price for us to yield up his spotless, sinless life for us on the cross. And he died and buried, but death could not hold him, the sinless Son of God. It was simply not possible that he should be holden of death. You see, Jesus had gone to the cross to do battle with the devil, with sin, with death itself. He seized sin and death and grappled with them and overcame their grip and arose the mighty victor. And he offers us in his victory a new relationship with God, a holy God, that was not possible otherwise. The gospel then is this, God's offer of amnesty, of forgiveness, of pardon. It's God's offer of reprieve, of grace and mercy. It's God's outstretched hand that offers us a free gift of eternal life, pardon, peace, and salvation, a Saviour, and we must come to him. I was reading last week an old catechism from Scotland called the Fisher's Catechism. It was called Fisher's Catechism because it was written by someone called Fisher. And it goes through four different types of faith. One of it is historical faith, simply believing certain events in history, like Jesus was born and died and rose again. And then there's temporary faith, where people believe for a wee while and then drift away. And there's faith of miracles. Jesus sometimes encountered people that followed him or listened because he did miracles. But the fourth type of faith is the faith that lasts and the faith that is needed, and that's saving faith when we rest and rely upon Christ alone as the reason for our salvation and come to him for refuge and receive him as the ground of our hope and our entitlement to everlasting life. And when we do that, we become Christians. And as Barnabas spoke, some did. They embraced the message, some for the first time. That message had penetrated their hearts. They had this sort of faith, not merely believing it intellectually, but turning to the Lord. They laid out their hand to reach or to receive God's outstretched hand. They were lifted out of themselves, and God's grace did something in them, and they were born anew of the Holy Spirit. And people today experience just this. They hear, they believe the gospel, and we accept it, and we say to the Lord, yes, this is for me, I will sign up for it. And just as soon a miracle is wrought, God does a mighty work in a person's life then. A new life begins. We're born anew of the Holy Spirit, of God's mighty power. And the Holy Spirit starts to change us inwardly, bringing goodness, purity, a renewed heart. And out of that comes the Christian deeds, the Christian love, the Christian kindness. And that is the gospel, God's free offer to us, a free gift of life. And yet, it costs us something, for we have to say farewell to the old ways, the old self that would put itself at the center, the old sinful self, along with its old, with its self-centered ways, that has to go. Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ. And that can be our experience too. Barnabas encouraged the believers to keep going in the faith, and we must keep going too through difficult times and not look back. Perhaps we can know and experience that grace anew for us, becoming like Barnabas, perhaps encouragers and enablers of others. Be glad to live for Christ and know his peace, to stand up for him and be counted, to be for others a witness to his love and renewing grace in a person's life. Let us pray. Loving and gracious and eternal God, as we come before you today, we thank you that you have set before us a way of life. And as we receive you anew and the power of your grace and Holy Spirit, may you do a work in us to make us more like Jesus, and to grant us your joy and peace in him. Amen. Let's sing now. Number 330, in full and glad surrender, I give myself to thee.
Let us pray. Father God, we come to you in faith and in hope, acknowledging your presence among us. Let our minds and our hearts be filled with stillness as we pray. In thankfulness and praise, we remember all of God's many blessings given to us each day. And our prayers focus firstly on the world in which we live. We remember the COP26 discussions and ask that great good may come from them. We think too of our mission partners, Keith and Ida Waddell, and pray that they may find a time of rest and recuperation when the time comes for them to take their leave in Scotland. We pray also for those in pain and distress, for those who know sorrow, and those who are in times of ill health, that they may be strengthened by Christ's presence, trusting in your love, which never fails. We remember the names of those we have promised to pray for: Maureen, Kathleen, Fiona, Karen, and Rosemary. In church today, we also think on those recently bereaved: Doreen and Jack. And we ask God's blessing for those in care homes: Mary, Christina, Brenda, Moira, Pat, Jesse, Isabel, James, and John. We think too of those whose world has been turned inside out by the pandemic. Grant that they would know the support and care of others, the help they need, and the strength to carry on. Lord Jesus, you suffer with us, and through your resurrection, you have taken our sufferings into the heart of God. Help those who are alone and vulnerable. Know that you have been there too, that you are with them, even when we cannot see you, even when they blame you. And for us, Lord, help us to be open and willing to be part of the answer to these prayers, to be your hands to care, your ears to listen, the body through which you might bring healing and life. These things we pray through Jesus Christ, our Saviour and our King, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Our hymn now, closing hymn, And Can It Be That I Should Gain an Interest in the Saviour's Blood.
I'm sure. died he for me, who caused this pain for me, to live, to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that and all in him. righteousness divine. Would I approach the eternal throne and claim the crown through Christ my own?
The peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, guard your hearts and your thoughts in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you and with all whom you love, both now and forevermore. Amen.
May God's blessing surround you.